If you will turn in your Bibles to the 14th chapter, the Gospel of Mark, beginning in verse 22, as we continue our study through the Word. Now, Jesus and his disciples, you will remember, they were in Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. And you'll remember throughout this final week of Jesus' ministry, how wave after wave of attack and assault was against Jesus and his ministry by the religious leaders. And so Jesus is pouring into his disciples. You'll recall as they were departing out of Jerusalem, how the disciples were commenting on how magnificent the structures were. And you'll remember that Jesus shocked them by saying that not one stone is going to stand upon another. The disciples continued out with Jesus and crossed over the Kidron Valley to the Mount of Olives. And you'll remember that Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked Jesus, when are these things going to take place and what are going to be the signs? And so Jesus gave that famous Olivet discourse there, talking about the signs of the times and his second coming. And afterwards, the disciples and Jesus, they continued out of town and to Bethany. And you'll remember that it was in Bethany that Jesus was there last time we saw, that he was the honored guest in a home of Simon the leper. And Simon the leper was hosting a feast for Jesus. It was there in Simon's house that Mary comes and anoints him, anoints his head and his feet with the expensive bottle of spikenard. And you will remember that Judas objected and encouraged the others to object as well because of the great value of that spikenard. But you'll remember that Judas had an ulterior motive, and that's because he kept the money bag and he wanted to see that money placed into the money bag because he was stealing from it. And Jesus defended her. You'll remember that he came to her defense and he said, what she has done is she's anointed my body for burial. Jesus is already pointing to the crucifixion and to his burial. And he says that wherever this gospel is preached, that she will be remembered for her lavish gift that she gave unto the Lord. You'll remember that afterwards, we saw how Judas then went to the religious leaders and bargained for Jesus. They asked him, what would you be willing to give me if I turn Jesus over to you? And so they negotiated and came to an agreement of 30 pieces of silver. And so Judas departed from there. And you remember that it was now Thursday morning, and Jesus sends two of his disciples into the city to prepare for the Passover. But rather than giving them an address, you'll recall that he tells them to go follow a man carrying a pitcher of water, and there you are to make ready. And they went and found it exactly as Jesus had said. The disciples had gathered together for their Passover meal. It's Thursday evening now. And so the Passover meal, what a great celebration that was. What a great feast it was. And the goal was to commemorate now the mighty works of God. It was a reminder to them of the greatness and the goodness of God. Can you imagine being a Jew back then in Jesus's day? And you are now in the Promised Land and you are in Jerusalem. And you are celebrating the mighty work of God. And how it was that God took a group of slaves there in Egypt and brought them out. And then he provided for them in the wilderness. He brought them out by his mighty outstretched arm. And he forced Pharaoh to release his grip upon God's people through the plagues that Moses was now calling forth as Pharaoh refused to let God's people go. But finally, there was one last plague. And that was the Passover. That was now the angel of death that was going to move through. And every firstborn son that did not have the blood of the lamb over the doorposts was going to be taken by the angel of death. And the Passover of judgment, this was now that celebration. He brings them out of Egypt and into the desert, into the wilderness, to Mount Sinai, where now the Ten Commandments and the law is given to them. But then he provided for them. Imagine this. For 40 years, he fed them every single day. He spread out manna on the desert for them to go and to collect, and he feeds them miraculously every single day for 40 years and gives them the supply of water that they will need in the wilderness. They were focused on God and on the things of God. Their camp was set up with the tabernacle in the middle, and then three tribes were to the south, to the north, and to the east, and to the west, for the 12 tribes would camp around the tabernacle, and every single tent was pitched facing inward to the tabernacle, so that when you got up in the morning and came out of your tent, the first thing that you would be looking at was the tabernacle of the Lord, and the Shekinah glory that dwelt there. When the Shekinah moved, you packed up and you moved with the Shekinah. If the Shekinah stayed, you stayed camp in that location until it moved. And so every single day, you never knew whether you were going to be pulling up stakes and going, or whether you were going to be staying there. And how God then brought them into the very land that he had promised that he would. And then he delivered it into their care. And there they were, living in their land that God had promised them, in Jerusalem, at the temple, celebrating the Passover. This was a great and exciting meal that you would gather together. And all of the elements from the salt water that would remind you of the tears of slaves when they were back in Egypt, to the unleavened bread and to the lamb, were all created and established to be able to point back and to remember the greatness and the goodness of God. But suddenly, in this festive Passover meal, halfway through it, Jesus says, "One of you is going to betray me." And suddenly now the mood changed in that room. It went from a time of celebration to a time of solemnness. And every single one of them began to ask Jesus the question, "Is it I? Is it I? Is it I?" Can you imagine having Thanksgiving dinner, and in the middle of the dinner, of the fun and the festivities of your Thanksgiving meal, somebody stands up and says, "Someone in here is going to betray me this day." That would change the dynamic of the rest of the meal, don't you think? I think that no longer would anybody be saying, "And what time are we having the pumpkin pie now?" So suddenly now, there is this heaviness and there is this tremendous solemnness. And Jesus would go on to say, "It's one of you who dip your bread with me." And you remember that it reminded us of the Psalm of David, where Ahithophel had raised up and betrayed David, and he laments that. And so the meal continues, and Judas now departs. And you'll remember after Jesus gives him the piece of bread that has been soaked in the sop, he now says to Judas, "What you do, do quickly." And Judas departs into the night. And now here they are with the strange exiting of Judas. They didn't completely understand what was going on with Judas. They thought that he was off on an errand that the Lord had sent him on, but odd in the middle of the Passover meal to excuse one out. And suddenly now Jesus is going to institute the Last Supper. And what he is going to do is he is going to put new meaning into the elements that were normal elements that were a part of the Passover, the bread and the cup. These were parts of the Passover, but Jesus is going to take that and now put a new meaning into it. So let's look as Jesus now institutes the Last Supper, the Lord's Supper. Verse 22, "And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.'" Now, we see that Jesus institutes what we call the Lord's Supper or the Eucharist. Now, the word Eucharist actually comes from a Greek word that means to give thanks. And so Jesus gave thanks and he broke and he blessed the bread. And he takes it now. And normally, the head of the meal, the head of the family, at a Passover, at a Seder, would take that bread and he would then offer up this prayer. He would say, "This is the bread of affliction, which our fathers ate in the land of Egypt. Let everyone who hungers come and eat. Let everyone who is needy come and eat the Passover meal." And so the bread would then be broken and passed out. But Jesus takes the bread and he doesn't offer the traditional Passover blessing on it. Instead, he now says to them, "Take, eat. This is my body." And he passes out the bread. And so Jesus now reinterprets these elements in verse 23. "Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said to them, 'This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many.'" So here we see that he pours new meaning into the cup as well. Now, Jesus accomplished this new covenant on the cross when he was crucified. That was the breaking of his body, and that was the shedding of his blood. Now, the old covenant, we see that that was established in the blood of animals. But the new covenant wasn't established in the blood of animals. It was established in the blood of God's own Son, in Jesus Christ. We see that Jesus's work on the cross, it completed the old covenant. It fulfilled the old covenant, and we see that it instituted, it brought forwards the new covenant. In verse 25, Jesus now says, "Assuredly, I say to you, I will no longer drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." And so Jesus looks forwards. He points forwards to a time that he will now celebrate the Passover with the bride of Christ. Now, Jesus has not celebrated the Passover up in heaven. That is yet to come. That meal that he is talking about and pointing forwards to, that doesn't happen yet because his bride has not been gathered together. When he comes and collects his bride, then he goes back to heaven. Remember that the groom would come to the bride's house, would get the bride, and then go back to the groom's house, and there they would celebrate the marriage. So Christ is going to come. The rapture is him collecting his bride, and then we are going to return back to his Father's house, and there we are going to celebrate the marriage supper of the Lamb, and that is when Jesus is going to drink once again of the cup. He says it is in the kingdom of God. So this is the fulfillment in the kingdom that Jesus is longing for, and it is the fulfillment that we long for, to be able to celebrate this feast, the marriage supper of the Lamb. Now, we see that the Passover meal finishes, completes, and it says in verse 26, "And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives." And so they now sing a hymn. And I want you to know that the Passover hymns are taken from Psalms 115 to 118. And so Jesus is singing these psalms with the disciples at the end of the Passover meal. But I want you to listen to some of the verses of those psalms that Jesus was singing on the night that he is headed over to the Garden of Gethsemane, on the night when Judas has now left the Passover meal and is off betraying Jesus, and on the night before he is going to be crucified, he is going to be scourged, and he's going to be handed over to sinners. So he has finished his meal, instituted the Lord's Supper, and then he's singing these verses. And I want you to imagine what that had to have been like for Jesus to be singing out these words that have been recorded in the scriptures. Psalm 116 says, "I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications, because he has inclined his ear to me. And therefore, I will call upon him as long as I live. The pains of death surrounded me, and the pangs of Sheol laid hold of me. I found trouble and sorrow, and then I called upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I implore you, deliver my soul. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. O Lord, truly I am your servant. I am your servant, the son of your maidservant. You have loosed my bonds. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. And this was the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. And as Jesus is singing these psalms, these words, he is heading over to the Mountain of Olives. In verse 27, and then Jesus said to them, all of you will be made to stumble because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. And so Jesus, in quotes from Zechariah 13:7, applies it to this situation. And so he adds sorrow onto sorrow. He had already told them that one of you is going to betray me. And now he turns around and says, all of you are going to depart from me. And we see that Jesus then encourages them in verse 28. But after I have been raised, I will go before you to Galilee. So Jesus is looking beyond the cross, looking to the resurrection. And he is still going to be leading them even after his resurrection. And so Jesus was looking past the cross. He had fixed his eyes. Hebrews 12:2 says, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. And what was the joy that was set before him that he had to endure the cross to get to that joy? We are that joy. He was rescuing us from sin, and he was now purchasing the bride of Christ in his own shed blood. That was his joy that was set before him. And so Jesus tells them, every single one of you is going to stumble. Every single one of you is going to scatter from me tonight. And we see Peter's response in verse 29. And Peter said to him, even if all are made to stumble, yet I will not be. And so this is what Peter said. Jesus, you're wrong. And he tells Jesus that he's wrong. You know, you might be right about the rest of these guys over here, but you made a mistake about me. You are wrong with regards to me. And he says, even if everybody else stumbles. And so he insisted to Jesus that he was the exception. He was claiming, listen to this, he was claiming greater allegiance than the rest of the disciples. So how do you think that played when they heard that and heard Peter say that there? And so he tells Jesus that he is wrong, and here we see that Peter is boasting in his flesh. We see 1 Corinthians 10:12 tells us, therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. And so Peter has forgotten. He has forgotten his own human weakness. He has forgotten the strength of the enemy's temptations. And so we see that he fails to recognize that we can only stand by the grace of God through the help of the Holy Spirit. Amen? That none of us can stand in our own strength. In our flesh, we have no capacity to withstand the spiritual oppression that comes from the enemy. What we need is an empowerment from the Holy Spirit that strengthens us, that enables us to be able to resist the weight of spiritual opposition that's in our life. And so here we see that what Peter is doing is he's making an emotional response. You see, he believes in his heart that there's no way that he could ever deny the Lord, that there's no way that he could ever run from the Lord. Peter's wheelhouse is courage and boldness and strength. That's who he is at his core. And he thinks that those core strengths are going to be able to keep him firmly rooted in the face of spiritual opposition. But your flesh is never going to get victory. The strength of your flesh is never going to get victory over spiritual opposition in your life. And oftentimes, that is the very area that we fail in, because there is a pride that happens that we think that we are self-sufficient, but we are no match in the flesh for spiritual opposition. And so we see here that Peter was unaware both of the spiritual reality and also the spiritual battle that Jesus clearly saw coming. Jesus saw the spiritual troops marching on. He says, tonight's going to be a long night, and you guys are all going to be in a battle for your lives, and all of you guys are going to scatter. But because Peter could not discern, he could not see the spiritual reality of the things that the Lord was saying, he was only talking through the eyes of his flesh. And so he tells the Lord, there is no way that I am ever going to scatter from you. You are wrong, Jesus. And so Peter calls Jesus out and tells him that he's wrong in front of the rest of the disciples. And so Jesus responds to that. He now addresses Peter directly in verse 30. First, he had just ministered to everybody collectively. But when Peter told him that he's wrong, now Jesus is going to respond to Peter directly. In verse 30, Jesus said to him, "Assuredly, I say to you that today, even this night, before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times." Now, it's interesting, in the other gospel accounts, we don't have the record of the fact that Jesus said that the rooster is going to crow twice. Think about that. That's a detail that only comes from Mark. And remember that Mark is Peter's nephew. So that was an eyewitness detail now that Mark puts in, having heard Peter tell him and recount the story to him. But that adds a measure of grace. That means that Peter is going to hear a rooster crow a first time as a warning to him that he is about to fail before he hears it for the second time after he has already failed. And so Peter, we see, is called out by the Lord. Now, it's interesting because the Bible tells us that love covers a multitude of sin. Notice that Jesus didn't first start by identifying Peter. He just told them, you all were going to scatter. It wasn't until Peter boasted in his own flesh and told the Lord that he was wrong that now we see Jesus identifying Peter specifically and that he was going to fail. So he says, no, Peter, I am right. You are wrong. You are going to fail. You are going to scatter. But on top of everybody scattering, you're going to deny that you even know me. And you're going to do that three times tonight before the rooster crows in two times. And in verse 30, we see Peter's repentance. He says, Lord, I'm sorry. You're right. I don't know what I was thinking. Praise God. No. That's what it should have said, though, isn't it? But the Lord says, no, Peter, you're wrong, and you're going to deny me three times. And in verse 31, Peter goes, no, Lord, you're wrong, and I'm right. And we see that he digs in his flesh even more. It says in verse 31, but he spoke more vehemently, if I have to die with you, I will not deny you. And they all said likewise. So here we have Peter saying, Jesus, you're wrong. Jesus telling Peter, Peter, no, you're wrong. And then all the disciples have to pick who they think is right or wrong. And they all go, let's see, Jesus or Peter? Jesus or Peter? We're going with Peter on this one here. And they all go in against the Lord and tell him, Lord, you're wrong. We're right on this. We are definitely not going to deny you, right? We're not going to deny you. We agreed. We are not going to deny you. So you're wrong. And it doesn't say so, but I think the Lord just shook his head. Because the reality is Jesus knows what's going to happen. And you see, truth is always made manifest by our children. In other words, when you have truth on your side, time is always on your side. It is when you're operating in deception or a lie that you need to move quickly before there's exposure of what is truly happening. But when truth is being governed, then time is on your side, because truth is always going to be borne out. Jesus isn't threatened by their lack of reception of his words. He has stated it and declared it. They have chosen to reject it, but in time they will find that Jesus' words are absolutely accurate. And you know, that's true of all of Jesus' words, and not just for those disciples, but for everyone. Jesus came to reveal truth about this world, about heaven, about sin, about salvation, about redemption, about what will happen. And every single word that Jesus said will come to pass and will be fulfilled. Every promise in the Bible is true. Not one dot or tittle, the smallest mark, grammatical mark in Hebrew, is going to be left unfulfilled. And so Jesus declares it, and God has revealed it, and we can trust it, or we can say, no, God, you're wrong. I think I know better, and this is the way the world works, and the reality behind these things. And God gives to everybody free will to choose to receive his words or to reject his words. And so here are his disciples, after spending the 3 years with him in his earthly ministry, have seen him do every single different miracle imaginable. And yet, when it comes to the revelation of a truth about themselves that was hard for them to comprehend, they chose to believe that Jesus was wrong rather than face the reality of their own weakness in their own lives. And that can still happen in our own lives. As the Lord reveals things to us that are difficult for us to accept about ourselves, we have that choice between denying the revelation or receiving the truth and allowing the Lord to minister to us, to help us to grow and to continue to step forward. What should have happened when the Lord said, all of you are going to made to scatter tonight, they should have said, Lord, what can we do? How can we prepare ourselves for what's coming? And what instruction would you give for us? But they never got the instruction or the preparation, because they argued with them and told them that it wasn't going to happen. So they never equipped themselves for the reality of what was going to happen. God will equip us for the battles that are coming ahead if we will listen to him, if we will humble ourselves and receive the things that he's trying to say to help lead and guide us and mold us to shape us. He wants your life to be filled with blessings. He wants you to avoid the potholes and the failures and the mistakes because of the consequences that they bring into our lives. And he wants to steer us around those and to fill our lives with blessing if we will humble ourselves and listen. He's not going to force us. He didn't force the disciples. He didn't get into a contest with them and start, you know, saying, what do I have to do to prove to you that I know what's going to happen? You see all my miracles, you know, and you still don't believe me? And, you know, he doesn't flesh out and get into it with them. He just leaves it. He spoke the truth, and now receive it or don't receive it. That's up to you. And that's the way that God works. He doesn't force himself. He doesn't press himself. But he talks to you, and he helps you, and he'll lead you, and he'll guide you, and he'll convict you, and he'll tell you when you're wrong, and when you need to go back and apologize. I'm not going to apologize to them. You know, you see the way they treated me, and the way they talked. You were wrong. You know, and you know, we argue with the Lord. I don't know if that ever happens. It happens to me, you know, and the Lord will minister, and then you have the opportunity to receive it, be directed by it, or to continue to walk in your flesh. So we see here that they come now to Gethsemane, verse 32. Then they came to a place which was named Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. And he took Peter, James, and John with him, and he began to be troubled and deeply distressed. And then he said to them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch. And he went a little farther, and he fell on the ground and prayed. And he prays. So he comes with the 11, he drops the 8 off at the gate and tells them to wait there. He goes into this garden called Gethsemane. It's a compound word in Hebrew that means the press of the olive. And so it's the olive press. And that was the name of this garden, a place that that Jesus goes to. And so the 8 are stopped. He brings Peter, James, and John in a little bit further. And then he tells them to just watch and to pray that his soul is exceedingly sorrowful. And so he goes a little farther and he falls on the ground. Listen to that. He doesn't kneel, but he falls. He collapses onto the ground on his face. He is in distress. And we see that it says that that he was sorrowful even to death. He falls on the ground and prays, and it says in verse 35 that if it were possible that the hour might pass from him. And so as he now is hours before, this is Thursday night, and he's waiting to be arrested now in the Garden of Gethsemane. He is going to go through the trials that night, and by 9 o'clock the next morning, he's going to be hanging on a cross. The crucifixion at 9 a.m. Friday morning. And so here he is in the nighttime, and he falls on his face. Now is the time that he is going to be arrested, and his back is going to be flayed open by a Roman scourge. He's going to have a crown of thorns smashed into his head. He's going to have his beard pulled from his face and suffer all types of abuse. And now as he ponders taking the cup filled with all of the sins of humanity, him who knew no sin, spotless in his perfection, is going to drink upon himself all of the sins of the world. And underneath that trial that lay in front of him, he collapses and he prays. And he asks God, is there any way that this hour might pass from him? He's saying, you know, when we talked about this and I agreed to this before time ever was, he says, I knew that this moment would come, but now that it's here, we never actually talked about a plan B. Is there a plan B? Is there any other way that the sins of mankind can be washed off of their souls, that I can gather them together and we can spend all eternity together in heaven? Is there any other way that we can accomplish that without my body having to be torn to shreds, to have nails piercing my hands and my feet? Is there any way that this hour might pass? In verse 36, and he said, Abba, which means daddy, daddy, father, all things are possible for you. He's saying, I know that you are omnipotent, you are all powerful, that you can do anything. All things are possible for you. Take this cup away from me. Take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will. And we see that his desire is to have that cup taken away, but his greater desire is that the will of God would be done. In verse 37, then he came and found them sleeping and said to Peter, Simon, are you sleeping? Could you not watch 1 hour? And I believe he singles Simon out. They all were sleeping, but I believe he singles Simon out because Simon had boasted that even if all of them failed, he wouldn't fail. And here he is sawing logs with the rest of them. Watch and pray, he says, verse 38, lest you enter into temptation, which means lest you succumb to temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. I just want to remind you that they have just eaten a big meal. They've just eaten the big Passover meal. Their stomachs are full. They've had a long day. It's nighttime, and now they're trying to do a spiritual activity, but their flesh is not cooperating with them. The spirit is willing, but the flesh, oh, how it is weak. Have you ever experienced the weakness of your flesh when it comes to the willingness of it, your spirit? Have you ever had that experience experience where you're going to pray and you're all set and you've sat down and now you are really going to intercede and you are going to pray and you start praying and all. It's like, man, you know, it lasted about 35 seconds and all of a sudden praying. Or the Word of God, you're going to read the Word of God and you're all set. I get in the chair, I got my light, I'm all ready, open up my chapters, I'm going to start reading the Word of God, and after a page or two, I'm like, oh, I'm so tired, you know. Do you know that this has even happened to people in church, I've heard, you know, where you are there, you're ready in church, I mean, you've just worshiped, and you're sitting in a comfortable seat and opening up the dinner as the pastor's preaching and all of a sudden, you know, do you know that that happens in other churches, that people, that is something that happens, and you know, and you have that experience, you know, we're sitting there and all of a sudden you're trying so hard and you're fighting it and your eyes doing this and the head starts, and then all of a sudden you do the head jerk, you know, where you jerk, and then you like look around, see if anybody noticed, you know, whether or not you did it and all of that and stuff. I mean, man, other churches have big problems with these kinds of things here and that, you know, and that where the flesh, you know, the spirit's willing. We got up, we got dressed, we're in church. Why is it that suddenly we're not tired before church, we're not tired after church? It's just right somewhere in the middle. Something happened, you know, right in the middle there. And that is that, you know, it is so hard to do spiritual activity. The flesh is in rebellion against spiritual activity. And so it will not cooperate and help you do the spiritual activity. The spirit is willing. But the flesh, no cooperation whatsoever when you want to do. That's why Jesus said, he didn't say to control the flesh, he said crucify the flesh. You just got to crucify because it's not going to cooperate with you. Crucify the flesh, pick up your cross and follow after me. And so the spirit, it longs for spiritual things. It longs for spiritual activities. It longs for spiritual calories and reading and worship and praying. But the flesh wants no part of it whatsoever at all. The spirit's willing. The flesh is weak. And in verse 39, it says, again, he went away and prayed and spoke the same words. And when he returned, he found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy and they didn't know what to answer him. He says, are you guys asleep again? They woke up and they're like, they didn't have, you know, that look on their face. They didn't even have an answer. You got something? I got nothing. You know, they didn't even know what to answer him. In verse 41, then he came the third time and said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? It is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners. And so we see Jesus comes and he says, are you still sleeping? I want you to know that Peter three times fails to obey the Lord before he denies him three times. Three times he was told to watch and pray. Three times he fails to obey the Lord. And ultimately, we're going to see. First, he starts by arguing. Then he's disobeying. And ultimately, we're going to see that he ends up denying. And so here we see, but Jesus says, it is enough. You couldn't watch for me, but I never stopped watching out for you. And you know, even when we're unfaithful to the Lord, he's still faithful. God is watching over you and he is taking care of you regardless of whether you're walking strong right now or it is a real battle in your life with temptation and sin. Whether or not you're faithful, God is always faithful. The Lord is always faithful to be trying to help you and to come alongside of you, to strengthen you and to protect you. It's enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand. And notice that Jesus doesn't flee. Here they're coming. Now, I want you to know that again, remember that the Temple Mount slopes down into the Kidron Valley and then up on the Mount of Olives. When you're on the Mount of Olives, You can see everything that's happening across the way on that Temple Mount as a torchlight brigade of soldiers that says a multitude had come to arrest him. These are both Roman soldiers and also the Temple Mount. Now, the Temple Mount, they carried clubs, but the soldiers carried swords. And so what happened is when the decree was given to go and arrest Jesus, they didn't just take the temple police. They also enlisted the help of Roman soldiers as well that came with their swords, because remember, it's Passover, and so even though it's nighttime, people are still everywhere packed into the city, and they don't know how much resistance that's going to end up happening. And if everybody starts to cry, you know, that Jesus is being arrested in a whole tumult, so they bring all of these soldiers, but the soldiers come with their torches, and so there's this whole torchlight of the multitude as it comes down out of the city and now crosses over and starts to come into the Mount of Olives where Jesus and his disciples is. And Jesus watches the torchlight, no doubt, as it comes. And then it's time now. And he goes and he wakes up the disciples right as the multitude is arriving there to him. And so he says, "See, my betrayer is at hand." And immediately, verse 43, it says, "While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, with a great multitude," look, with swords and clubs, "came from the chief priests and the scribes and the elders." And it says, verse 44, "Now his betrayer had given them a signal, saying, 'Whomever I kiss, he is the one. Seize him and lead him away safely.' And as soon as he had come, immediately he went up to him and said to him, 'Rabbi, Rabbi,' and he kissed him. And then they laid their hands on him and took him." Now, for a disciple to greet by saying "Rabbi" and kissing, this was normal. But the issue was they didn't know which one was Jesus. It was dark. They only had torches. And so a prearranged signal had been given. But here is the thing, that greeting and that kiss, that is a statement of love and respect and trust. And he took that emblem of trust and respect and love and poured into it treachery, into that act of that kiss. And so they lay hands on him. And verse 47, "And one of those who stood by drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his ear." Notice in Mark's gospel, he doesn't tell you who it was, that it was his uncle. He spares that part there. And the other gospel writers don't tell you either. Matthew and Mark don't, and Luke. But John tells us in his gospel that it was Peter. And also tells us that it was Malchus was the name of the high priest's servant. And that Jesus took that ear and put it back onto Malchus and healed him right there. It says in verse 48, "And then Jesus answered and said to them, 'Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to take me? I was daily with you in the temple teaching, and you did not seize me, but the scripture must be fulfilled.'" And so why had they chosen to arrest him at night outside the city? And that's because they feared the people's reaction. It says in verse 50, "Then they all forsook him and fled." And so here we see the fulfillment of Jesus' words when he said, "You will all forsake me." And they all did. In verse 51, "Now a certain young man followed him, having a linen cloth thrown around his naked body. And the young men laid hold of him, and he left the linen cloth and fled from them naked," so his outer garment. Now, many scholars believe that this was Mark, that this was the Mark that wrote the gospel, that he inserted this little autobiographical piece of himself. Many believe that the Last Supper was held in his house, that that's where the upper room, and when the disciples left at the end, that he followed them. And then the guards came and they laid hold of him, and he wiggled out of his outer garment and he took off and he fled. So Jesus is now arrested, and he is going to undergo 6 trials, 3 religious trials and 3 civil trials from the Romans. And then he is going to be crucified at 9:00 the next morning. So we're going to continue to follow along Jesus's path to the cross next time. But I wanted to draw our attention in closing for a minute, just back to verse 36, back to where it says, "Take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will." Now, this was Jesus's prayer, not what I will, but what you will. And it struck me, have I ever prayed like that before? You see, every time that I pray, I ask for God to do things. I mean, that's what my prayer is. I'm asking God to help in a situation or heal somebody or this or that. But here we see that Jesus, he prays for his will, that the cup would be taken from him. But then he prays, but nevertheless, not my will. He says, if it counteracts your perfect will in my life, then disregard what my prayer request just was. Because although Jesus had a prayer request, what he wanted more than any other prayer request was the Father's will to be executed in his life. And the question just arose in my heart is, how much do we want the will of God in our life? You see, there's outside of the will of God, then there's the permissive will of God, and then there's the perfect will of God. When you're outside of the will of God, God gives you free will. He gave me free will. He gives you free will. He gives everybody free will. And we're to exercise that free will. When we disobey God, when we're sinning, we're outside of God's will. So outside of God's will, that is a rebellion against the will of God. That's using our free will to work in opposition to God's will. Then there's the permissive will of God, where it's not against his will. It's not a sin. It's not an area of sin or a sin issue, but it's not his perfect will for your life. And so if you want to do that, what happens is you're trading gold for copper. You can have the copper if you insist on it. He has gold for you if you will do it his way and where he wants you to lead. But what's happening in that situation is you want your will and you want God to bless your will. And so it's not God's will, but it's not a sin issue. So he says, okay, you can have it. Your will be done. I will give you your will and let you. That's the permissive will of God. And then there's the perfect will of God. And that's God's will. But that's God's will, listen to this, at the expense of your will in your life. You see, you have to let go of your will in order to receive God's will in your life. And he is only able to operate in your life to the degree that you've let go of your will in your life. Jesus completely let go of his will. Now, his will was different than the Father. We see that his will is to have the cup taken away. But his will was never in opposition to the will of the Father. He always surrendered his will to the will of the Father. So we see the personality differences between the Father and the Son, but we see the harmony and the submission. And so in our lives, how much of God's will do you want in your life? And may we seek after that in our lives. God's will for everybody, I can tell you this right now, is to draw closer to him, to be more connected, to have more of his love flowing into you and then flowing through you onto everybody that is around you. But in order to do that, we have to crucify the flesh. We have to die to ourselves. We have to allow God to operate in our lives. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Let's pray. Father, thank you, Lord. Bless us, help us, fill us, and strengthen us this day, Lord, as we seek more of you and less of ourselves. Help us to love you more fully and to love others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.